Ask him when the clinic opens.
Tomorrow. They're keeping it quiet, though, because some VIP's coming in. But he doesn't know who.
It's probably just a movie star.
Stars don't move.
Oh. Oh, go to hell, Annie TV. Go to hell. While the first two episodes of the series were called Part 1 and Part 2, this here is really the first true two-parter, and as such, I'll be grading the episodes together instead of separately. The Capture Part 1 opens at the fanciest restaurant you've ever seen inside a hotel conference room, where Jake and his family are having a nice night out. We learn that Jake's father has been spending the last 2 years working on getting a spa and beauty clinic off the ground, and is apparently so obsessed with the prospect of managing masseuses and steam room maintenance that he hasn't been paying attention to his family.
And I'll tell you what, I've almost got the clinic up and running, and in a couple of weeks I'll have plenty of time to go to games.
Except Tom's not on the team anymore.
Well, that was Tom's decision.
Mom, I wasn't questioning the validity of Tom's decision, just pointing out that Dad is a complete loser. Suddenly, the entire restaurant stirs as Victor Trent, aka Visitor 3 and Human Morph, starts walking around. Apparently, he's a very powerful and important man. Why he is remains a mystery. Visitor 3 takes a seat at Jake's table for, reasons. Apparently, Victor Trent and Jake's dad know each other. That's when a waiter brings in the escargot, which Visitor 3 and Tom refuse, probably because snails look a little too much like Yeerks. Because if there's anything the Yeerks need to further invalidate themselves with, it's a universal tell like not being able to eat escargot. In an admittedly amusing scene, Jake takes this rare opportunity to gross Visitor 3 out by savoring some delicious snail. Mm-hmm. I love Visitor 3's reaction. It's like he's seeing a dear friend die.
Paul. Oh, Paul, I'm so sorry.
After Visitor 3 leaves, Jake is asked to come help out at the clinic for its very special, very secret first client, and Jake agrees. Welcome to the wellness clinic. Handicapped? Well, fuck you, enjoy our steps and heavy doors. While on some off time, Jake chats with the rest of the team, who are all hanging around at the Cyber Cafe.
He's worried that his dad knows Visitor. Victor Trent.
Wow, good thing you caught yourself there, Rachel, or someone might have overheard you, like, Cassie. They all speculate who the mysterious first client might be.
Hey, maybe it's someone amazing like Jason Don McColl.
That would be so cool.
Because Jeremy Jason McColl was just too, Jeremy. This brings up the discussion about movie stars and Axe's audience-insulting comment about how stars don't move. Hey, Nickelodeon, Scholastic, the writers of this episode, whoever was responsible for the line, stars move all the fucking time. Ignoring the fact that they rotate like planets, stars also orbit around the center of the galaxy, the gravity of all the other stars and planets shifting around them, it's a fucking roller coaster up there. Now, if a character of lesser learning had said that stars don't move, like a child or a politician, that'd be one thing. But Axe is supposed to be the technobabble exposition guy. He knows science, and he's actually been in space. What you're doing is treating your audience like morons. And for that, a nice big fuck you to all y'all. Stars don't move. Shut up. At the clinic, things are getting weird. Men in suits are setting up extensive security measures, and guys start wheeling in barrels of mystery. Well, I don't know. Maybe the VIP is the Toxic Avenger.
Dad, where do you want all these files?
I'm afraid all non-essential personnel will have to leave before Governor Blair arrives.
Back at Cassie's bar, the Animorphs work things over. It turns out that the VIP is a governor who just recently announced his candidacy for president, and is more than likely a Yeerk target. Though, considering the effectiveness of the TV Yeerk invasion, the governor is probably running in the rent-is-too-damn-high party. The Animorphs decide they need to check this out, but need a way to get past security. So they decide to morph Bugs and... Oh, no, wait, this is Annie-TV. We need to find a more convoluted way to break in.
Marco, you rent movies.
And that's another thing. Thus far, the Animorphs have taken Axe to movies and talked to him about Planet Hollywood, and he apparently understands movie rentals, so how the hell did he not understand the concept of movie stars? Stars fucking move! So, Marco pulls out his movie rental card. Remember those. And, okay, this is happening. Huh.
Guess I won't be renting any more movies.
There. I've encrypted the card. It will now match any human security code.
Oh, okay, so, magic. Seriously, magic. How the else can you explain what Axe just did? Axe is a wizard, and he just used a magic spell. Is encrypting cards with your finger in complete arcane? Because I certainly didn't see it in the player's handbook. Magic! What the hell? Oh, and they decide to morph Bugs anyway. And Axe isn't going with them. Axe tends to not go on missions on the show for some reason. The four Animorphs reach the clinic and watch the governor arrive with Visor 3. Oh, top-notch security, guys. The Yeerks have one fucking job to do here, and they get Mr. Don't-Give-A-Crap on camera duty. While Jake, Marco, and Cassie go off to search the clinic, Rachel uses her mad hacker skills to get the security camera feed and discovers that the Yeerks have set up a Yeerk pool inside the clinic. Because that's easier than holding him down and infesting him when he's on the massage table, I guess. However, Rachel is too dumb to realize she's standing in front of a camera herself, and the worst Yeerk ever finally notices her.
I want this done as quickly as possible. The governor must have absolutely no suspicion.
Yes, sir.
What the hell? How is this security camera feed? Is the camera on a track or a crane? I don't know too much about security systems that incorporate long-ass dolly shots. Anyway, Rachel makes a run for it when security starts to crack down on her. Meanwhile, Axe's card refuses to work, making that whole bit with Analyte Magic completely pointless.
I don't get it. Axe said this could break any code.
Any human code.
So the Yeerks installed Yeerk card scanners for this one-time thing? To what end? Anyway, even in a two-parter, you only have so much time to work with, so I think it says something to the creative team behind this episode that they would waste their time on something as stupid as magically encrypted cards for it to not go anywhere. And it's made doubly pointless when they morph cockroaches later and get into the room through the ventilation system. Oh look, non-essential personnel. The Animorphs are forced to demorph in the vents, and their extra weight causes it to collapse and dump them in the room, Jake landing right in the Yeerk pool. While Cassie and Rachel pull him out, Marco jams the door with a flimsy plastic lawn chair. The Yeerks eventually start to break through, so Rachel morphs into a lion. Yeah! I don't know how, but I just pooped your pants. Rachel chases all the Yeerks out while Marco takes out the portable drone array. Man, if the Analytes had been armed with flimsy plastic lawn chairs, this war would have been over years ago! Eventually, Jake comes to and they all escape. But there's something not right with Jake. Dun dun dun!